Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Mary, seat of wisdom, pray for us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dear brothers and sisters, welcome back to this presentation on the Concilia, or Historical Christology. How the councils defined in very accurate terms who Christ is in the face of false teachings. We are going to enter into the third phase of this development. In the third phase, the fathers, because of the heresies, of course, took up the question of whether there are two operations in Jesus or whether there are two wills in Jesus, and if so, how are these two wills working together in harmony, in symphony? The question of two operations, two wills in Jesus. This is the third phase of the development of Christological doctrine. Now, the Second Council of Constantinople 553, this is not the council that faced this question, but this council reaffirmed the teaching of the Council of Chalcedon, and they clarified the coming together of the two natures. They said, and rightly, that the two natures, the divine nature and the human nature, did not come together to fuse to form one person and one hypostasis. Instead, the one person, the one hypostasis existed. It is the eternal Son. And the eternal Son possesses already the divine nature. So he assumes in time from the Blessed Virgin Mary the human nature, and thus the Word took flesh and dwelt among us. There was a clarification given. Now the Third Council of Constantinople is a council will explain how the two operations, the two wills, operate in Jesus, and there are two wills, etc. And took place between the year 680 to 681 Anno Domini. Now, what was the background of this? Patriarch Sergius of Constantinople, who died in 638, in an attempt to reconcile the Monophysite group, that is the Alexandrians, who had rejected the Council of Chalcedon, and they said the two natures come together to form one nature, monophysites, declared that two natures in Christ are there, but there is only one operation, one mode of activity. In other words, there is only one divine will, the thelema in Greek, in Christ, and one energia, the divine energy. And this heresy of one divine will only in Jesus is called monothelitism, from the word thelema, will, standing for will. This was supported by the edict of the emperor Heraclitus in 638, the same emperor who had gone and defeated Persians and brought the Holy Cross back to Jerusalem. He wanted unity in the empire, and he knew the section, the Alexandrians, had gone away from that unity, and he was trying to bring them back to the unity of the empire, but of course at the cost of faith. And what happened? A great man, Maximus, is a saint, the confessor, because of the suffering he endured. He was working in the imperial court as a secretary to the emperor before he left and joined the monastery, because he saw the church there was infected by monothelitic heresy, and the people were also not living, especially the ruling class were not living upright life. So he left and joined the monastery. Now, when the heresy was spreading, he went around teaching against the heresy, the Orthodox faith. And seeing that he did not receive much help, he went much later to Rome and informed the Pope, then the Pope Martin, who called a council, Lateran Council, regional council, which affirmed the positions of Maximus the Confessor and condemned the position of Sergius, the Patriarch of Constantinople, also the Patriarch of Alexandria, Antioch. In fact, all the three other patriarchates had gone along with monothelitism. He defended. And what did he teach? The teaching of Saint Maximus. Nature and mode of activity belong together inseparably, meaning if you have a human nature, you have a human will and a human intellect. If you have a divine nature, you should have a divine will and a divine intellect. You cannot separate the what belongs to the nature. And therefore, if there are two natures, there should be two wills, the human will and the divine will. The union between the two modes of activity or the symphony and harmony is possible not at the level of the nature, but only at the level of the person. It is the person who brings harmony or disharmony between these two wills. This is, he said, preeminently true of the Holy Trinity. Each divine person does not have his work or his will, because there is only one nature, which is the divine nature, and therefore there is only one will, one intellect in the Trinity. They all have the same will and the same omniscience. The Son, therefore, has no other work and will than the Father, but he works and wills what the Father wills in a way corresponding to the mode of being the Son. He works in a Son, not as the Father, but he carries out the will of the Father from eternity. And Maximus tried to clarify that by teaching this way. Each of us, he said, works not in so far as he is a who, but as a what, that is, in so far as a man. For example, if we are told to write as men, intelligent being, we all will write as men because we have the same human nature. But if a cow or a goat is told to write, it will not write because it does not have a nature that is capable of writing. Yet, when we write, I write, you write, so and so writes, we all write not exactly the same. We write according to our individuality. So he goes on, yet in so far as he is a who, Peter, for instance, or Paul, he gives shape to the manner, the purpose of his work by easing off or making effort and by giving his work this or that shape in accordance with his free will, with his individuality. Thus, when I write, you write, all of us write because we have the human nature, but our writings, our handwriting, our sentences, our structures all will differ because they flow from our personhood. That is how we recognize the distinction between persons in practice by the way, by the purpose of they do things. In the nature, what he calls the logos of the work, on the other hand, we recognize the natural operation common to all men. He is therefore using this to say that in the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, there is only one will, but each of them carries out that will according to the personal distinctions. Now, we proceed. Therefore, it is not the natural modes of activity, but the way or manner in which these work together that is single and unified. This is now about the Jesus. There are two wills, there are two modes of activity, but what is unique in Jesus is the manner, the purpose in which Jesus carries out these two wills. In the one person of Christ, divine and human, works together in an exchange, a mutual interpenetration, the perikleros, but the perikleros at the level of the person. The unity is not at the level of the nature, but at the level of the person. Hence, Maximus distinguishes between nature of the work and the manner of the work. The difference between the two wills consists of the human will being by nature different from the divine will. In Jesus, the natural will is fully integrated in a direction that is freely chosen, a direction given by the person, the word. The effect of this integration is that Jesus lives his human life entirely on the basis of his personal center, his existence as the Son. And for this teaching, that in Jesus there are two wills, but there is unity, harmony, because the person, the Word, makes the human will the same as the Father's will, so that when he acts, his human will and the divine will, the Father's will, are the same. And for this teaching, Maximus was subjected to the cruelest torments by the grandson of Heraclitus, Constans II, who was a grandson. What did they do? He was arrested, put in prison, tortured, because he had dared to go to Pope Martin and get this position condemned. So he was accused of treason, his tongue was cut out so that he will not speak again, and his right was or hand was cut off because he won't write again. Then he was exiled to Scemarum in Scythia, where he lived for another 3 years and died. And they say the Lord already told him when his death is going to happen, and when they buried on his tomb appeared through three candles. And the people took this as a sign that Maximus was teaching the true faith. So the third council of Constantinople meets after this. The council, of course, took the position of Pope Martin, who was also imprisoned for what he did, and Maximus, and defined that in Jesus there are two wills. And these two wills are united at the level of the person. And they used the same four adjectives that were used for the natures in Chalcedon, that they must confess to natures without division, without change, without separation, without confusion, as they come together in the person. So we must confess two wills in Jesus without division, without change, without separation, without confusion, as they come together in the unity. At the level of the person, the human will in Christ is totally submitted to the divine will, and there is no contradiction or dichotomy. When Jesus says, I came not to do my will, but the will of the Father who sent me. So the Father's will, he makes his human will the same as that of the Father. How? Through submission, through obedience. This total submission of the human, the divine will, also shows that the human will of Christ is at the same time God's own will. The belonging of the human will to the divine subject excludes any dichotomy in Christ. So Jesus is not someone who suffers from some form of, psychological dysfunction. No, he has only one activity, one movement. The existence of a real human will is an essential condition for the truth of Jesus' humanity. Humanity is saved by the free human act of Jesus from Nazareth. Adam had corrupted his will through disobedience. Jesus now rectifies the human will by making it possible that the human will surrenders to the divine will. Thus, the Lord carried out in deed and truth through his suffering as man in obedience that never overstepped the line what he himself had predetermined as God to be carried out, says Benedict XVI. The act of redemption lies not in relinquishing his human will, but in his wishing, transforming even as man, his will to be that of the Father's will. So the prayer of Jesus, says Benedict, not my will, but thy will be done, is not the prayer of man Jesus addressing God, but the prayer of the Son, who, having subsumed the fullness of man's will into himself, is now transforming it into the will of the Son, meaning the will of the Father. Yeah, there is an important teaching for everyone's spiritual life. Spiritual life is a question of learning to do God's will and surrendering ourselves to the Holy will. But in us, also, just like in Jesus, there can be a tension between the human will and the divine will. For us, the divine will is exterior. We come to know it in the interior of our hearts. Our human will, if it were to be free from the consequences of original sin, would tend towards synergy or synergia and the divine will. Opposition in man between his will and God's will is because of sin. Man regards consenting to God's will not as an opportunity to become fully himself, but as a threat to his freedom. Unfortunately, the transition between the two wills from opposition to union is accomplished through the sacrifice of obedience, and the essence of spiritual life is learning to do that, to transform my will to be the will of the Father. There is no opposition, but there is harmony. Jesus learned obedience and was thus made perfect. His final S to the Father on the Mount of Olives consecrated him as a priest according to the order of Melchizedek. Jesus' obedience becomes life for all, and our obedience also will become life for God. Therefore, learn this implication for our Christian life. Implication of the union of two wills. Christian life presupposes two wills in operation, the human will and divine will. Divine will can be the declared will of God, according to St. Francis de Sales, or the permissive will of God. Declared will of God is what God has already revealed to you, revealed to us, through the commandments, to our state of life, through the teachings, etc. Permissive will of God is what God allows to happen. And both belong to the will of God. Human will, from within the person, what he or she wants for himself, his choices, this is determined by one's own personality, the world around us, fallen nature. That is our human will. Now, divine will is the will of the Father for us. Spiritual life consists in discerning God's will vis-a-vis our human will, making or accepting God's will our own, and trusting God and his plans are best for us, and obeying. Often, especially in the early stages, there may be a struggle. However, through a life of obedience of faith, making God's will one's own, we can grow in holiness, and the end result is peace, joy, love, and happiness. Holiness, or lack of it, is determined how we exercise our will. Do we exercise it in obedience to God or in rebellion to God? Do we exercise like Christ, who learned to obey through suffering, or are we like Eve and Adam, who rebelled against God? And we conclude there, and next we shall go to the Council of Nicaea. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be.